The Bible talks about the fact that God actually called Saul to be the king of Israel. The Bible says the Israelite demanded for a king, and God said, I will make a king for you. And God chose the person of Saul. Saul was a nobody. Saul, when it comes to spiritual matters, was a nonentity. He didn't know anything about spiritual matters. As a matter of fact, if God were to go by his standards in court, Saul wouldn't have been the person to choose. Because in spiritual matters, Saul was ignorant. And if you're not spiritually sound, you cannot lead the people of God. The people of God can be very complex and very complicated. Go and ask Moses. He has a lot of story to tell. And here was a man, ignorant of everything. God chose him, and God gave him everything to fulfill his purpose for his life. As God has given some of us pastors, all we need sometimes is just the pastors to open our eyes, to open our ears to why God has created us. And he refused to listen. He disobeyed God. He obeyed God partially. But in the presence of God, partial obedience is total disobedience. Partial disobedience is total disobedience. And so he disobeyed God. And God said, well, I've given you a long rope to pull. Because you are not going to repent of your ways, I will take the mandate from you. I'm still going to share that later on. I will take the mandate from you. I will render you homeless and useless. I will render you irrelevant to my plan. 1 Samuel chapter 15, verses 20 to 23. 1 Samuel chapter 15. And Saul said unto Samuel, yeah, I have obeyed the voice of the Lord. That was what he said. He said, I have obeyed and have gone the way which the Lord has sent me, and I've brought Agag the king of Amalek, and I've utterly destroyed the Amalekites. I'm reading 1 Samuel chapter 15, 20 to 30. Is it possible to display the scriptures on the screen? And I've utterly destroyed the Amalekites, verse 21. But the people took of the spoil, sheep and oxen, and the sheep of the things which should have been utterly destroyed. Listen, he said, and the people. For me, you see, he quickly got himself out of the people. He dissociated himself from collective decision. He said, I have obeyed the voice of God. I have done everything that God has said. But the people, you see, left for me, I have obeyed. But the people, see, these people, it's the people. He said, the people said they were the ones that refused to obey God. But you are the leader. You'll be held accountable. You'll be held responsible. Praise the Lord. And that's why, as pastors, to whom much is given, much is expected. When God commits something to your hands, he believes that you should be responsible to take care of what he has committed into your hands. That is why, even as pastors, when we correct, we are not saying it out of pride. We are saying it because that is a mandate that God has given unto us. When we tell our sisters, please cover up your nakedness, we're not being rude. That is just what God has committed into our hands. Praise the Lord. And we say it as it is. But this man here said, you know, I don't want the people to be offended. And that is the downfall of so many pastors and so many leaders. When you are trying to dance to the tune of the people, you have missed purpose in life. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And so, he said, the people, they have disobeyed God. And Samuel said, the Lord has great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices, as in obeying the voice of God. Samuel was telling Saul, everything else you do in the kingdom is irrelevant out of obedience. You are paying your tithe, you are disobedient, your tithe has no meaning. You are working for God, maybe in the choir or in the usher, maybe the pastor, whosoever you are, whatever you are doing for God, outside of obedience is not acceptable unto God. It's zero. You are not a backbiter. You are very quiet, easygoing brother or sister, very respectful. You come to church on time. They see you as responsible in court, but you are living a life of disobedience and you know it. God says everything. That is why the Bible says that God does not see the way man sees. God doesn't see the way man sees at all. One requirement from God, as a matter of fact, that lays the foundation for everything you will do in the kingdom is obedience. If you cannot obey God, you have no business in destiny. Because you will use your own hands to destroy yourself eventually. That is what happens. And that is why I want to please plead with each and every one of us as children of God. Let the word you are hearing today sink into your spirit. Let the word you are hearing today lay the foundation of your life. If the foundation be destroyed, what can the righteous do? The foundation for the kingdom is obedience to the word of God without compromise. The foundation of God stands sure, having this seal. The Lord knoweth them that are his, and let every man that nameth the name of the Lord depart from iniquity. That is the standard. That is the foundation. Then you can start building. But the challenges we see in the church, the problems we see in the church today, and why we are praying for revival and we are not experiencing revival is because we are living a life of disobedience. And God says, I cannot build revival on disobedience. Keep praying, keep fasting. Do all the programs that you can. Do all the gimmicks. If obedience does not lay the foundation, I cannot do anything. Our generation, we are waiting for revival. Years back, I went for a vigil, and that man of God was actually sharing that sometimes, I think, the Azusa ministry, many of us who know anything about Azusa ministry, was between 1906 and 1910. It was a great revival that our generation has never experienced. Very great revival. People were coming from all over the world for that revival. And when the revival was going to die down, a prophet of God stood and spoke that before the world, we experienced this similar revival. It's going to take 100 years. That is 1910. And we are in 2010. This is the season when we must experience another great revival. This is the season we must experience apostolic revival. But it will not come, regardless of that prophecy, if we do not lay the foundation on obedience. It will not come. Remember, God told Abraham, your seed will spend 400 years in the land of slavery. Why is it that they spent 430 years? I think there's a question about 30 years because God said 400 years. Why 430? Praise the Lord. And so sometimes we delay the programs of God for our lives because we refuse to live a life that is pleasing to him. Tell your neighbor, live a life of obedience. Tell your neighbor, do not sell your birthright. Say loud and clear, do not sell your birthright. Say it this way, don't do down payment. Say loud and clear, don't do down payment. You know how we do down payment? you know, we're going to marry each other, right? We're going to marry each other, we love each other. Oh, I love you. But let's do down payment first. Let's test it out first to see if it works. It doesn't work like that. You see, try each other out, you know, and don't really know if we're... Don't do down payment. Tell your neighbor once again, don't do down payment. Say loud and clear, do not do down payment. If you do that down payment, and you expect God, and that's what some of us do. We do down payment, and we expect God to pay the rest. It doesn't work like that. You say, you need the down payment, you take care of the bill. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Samuel said, the Lord has great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord. So behold, to obey is better than sacrifice. Everything you have to offer in the kingdom is not relevant outside of obedience. To obey is better than sacrifice and to hearken than the fat of rams. Verse 23, see how God sees disobedience. For rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. There are so many people in the church of God who practice witchcraft. I'm telling you, we have people who practice witchcraft in our midst. Our understanding of witchcraft is not broad enough. We have, especially people from Africa, we have very little understanding of what witchcraft is all about. We believe that witchcraft are those people that hold meetings at night and they call destiny and they create some fear. And, you know, they believe that those are the people that practice witchcraft. But if you have a very deep understanding of the scriptures, the Bible says that when you disobey God and you continue to live a life of disobedience, you are practicing witchcraft.